So welcome to the next video. In this video, we will look at how a computer solves linear systems. And as you could grasp from the title of this video, it is done using a method called LU decomposition. Basically, we factorize our matrix, say A, as L times U, where L is lower triangular and U is upper triangular, and then we can solve the linear system in a convenient way. So let's look at an outline of our talk here. So first I will describe briefly how you would solve linear systems by hand, which is using Gaussian elimination. And then I try to point out what a computer does in principle and how it differs from that. We will also see that a computer, since it uses numerical methods, you sometimes have to swap rows. You have to swap the order of the equations that you're solving to get good numerical results. I will have a brief discussion of application of LU decomposition in the real world. Sometimes you may wonder if all these numerical methods are actually being used. So I copied a webpage where you can see it is being used. And I will shortly indicate how linear systems can be solved using MATLAB, so which built-in routines are connected to solving linear systems. So let's see. First of all, the problem we're considering is that given is a linear system AX equals B, A is square matrix, and we assume it has an inverse, it's non-singular. So then we know that there is a unique solution X to the linear system. The right-hand side B is given, and we try to find X. Now, the formal solution is, of course, X is A inverse times B. So you could compute the inverse matrix using some method and then multiply A inverse with B. But I will try to indicate that this is much more expensive than using LU decomposition, what we will be doing. So that will come in a minute. So it is not how we compute the solution. Now, how would you do this by hand? First, let's look at a toy linear system, a small 3x3 linear system. We have the equations here. We can write that as AX equals B. X is what we would like to compute, and the right-hand side B is the vector with components 1, 1, and 3. So if you do that by hand, here is the linear system again. What you probably have been taught in previous courses is to add your vector B as an extra column to your matrix, and then use Gaussian elimination. So you're going to multiply rows with a number, subtract rows, and so on, and you try to get to the identity matrix for the first three columns. And then the fourth column is going to be the solution of the linear system. So let's see. So I have the entries. I have the entries of my matrix here. So this is the matrix A. This here is the added right-hand side vector B. And what I'm going to do, I look at the first row here. I would like this 2 to become a 1. So I divide everything by 2. And then the new first equation is the one I had divided by 2. And next what I do is I look at this new first equation and I use it to create a 0 here and a 0 here. And the way we do that is for the new second equation is the old one minus 4 times the new first equation. Then we get a 0 here. And for the third equation, I have to subtract twice the new first equation. So the new third equation is the old one minus 2 times the new first equation, so that would be this one. And if I do that, I create a 0 here. So then next step is that we look at this lower 3x2 block, sorry, 2 rows, 3 columns block, and we would like this 2 to become a 1. So again, we divide by 2. We divide by 2 and this becomes a 1 here. So these entries are all divided by 2. And then we use this new second row to create a 0 at this position and at this position. And if you do that, and if you do not make mistakes, then you will get to this form where we have divided then the last row by 4 to get a 1 there too. So now the original matrix A that was here has been transformed into an identity matrix. And it means that this right-hand side vector has changed along, and this is the solution to our linear system. So apparently the solution vector is -1/2, -1, 1. So that is what you would do by hand, and I trust you've seen that before. Now, a computer does it a little bit differently. So let's compare the way we did it on this slide with the way a computer would do it. So what a computer does is it does not consider the right-hand side vector B, so it just works with the matrix. It does not create ones on the diagonal, so it doesn't do the division by the diagonal entries. And finally, it only creates zeros below the diagonal. So before we also created zeros above the main diagonal, we're not going to do that. And then as a bit of extra, we're doing a bit of bookkeeping, which means that we store how we changed our equations, and what that means will become clear in a second. So let's see what we do. So we start with the matrix A only. Then we use the first row like before to create zeros below it. So the 4 and the 2 should become zeros. So to get to that, the new second equation is the old second equation minus 2 times the first equation. Because if I subtract twice this equation from the second row, then I get a zero in the first column. But instead of writing down that zero, I write in red how it changed. So this 2 here ends up here. So instead of writing the zero, I write this 2 there. And for the last row, this 2, 5, 9, I have to subtract once this thing, so minus 1 times the first equation, and the 1 ends up here. And how the third row changes, well, you get a 4 and a 6 here. One more step, because I want to create zeros below the main diagonal, so the only thing bothering me is this 4 here, that should become a 0. How can you do that? Well, the new third equation should be the old one, minus 2 times 2 times the second equation. So now I've done a couple of steps, but it's not clear yet how this helps us. So what we're going to do, so this is a result of our Gaussian elimination. What we're going to do is we're going to introduce two new matrices. The first one is lower triangular, this matrix L. And basically L follows from these red entries in the matrix that I have here. So it's lower triangular. It has ones on the diagonal, so basically this part I can already write down because it has zeros above the diagonal, ones on the diagonal. And then below the diagonal I put the red number, so the coefficients used in the Gaussian elimination process. Then I also introduce a U matrix here. And this U is basically, well, all the blue numbers that we have left here. And below the main diagonal, I write zeros. So let's write it down, upper triangular matrix. The result after Gaussian elimination, I have called it. And you can verify, you can prove that. I'm not going to do that. It's basically bookkeeping. But the way we constructed our L and our U is a clever way of finding a factorization. So we have written A as L times U, with L lower triangular and U upper triangular. And this is called the LU decomposition. I decompose my matrix into two submatrices, or LU factorization. So how does this help us? Because I was originally trying to solve a linear system. Now I have find this factorization. So basically I am now stuck with LUX equals B. Now, if I call this thing, this UX, if I call that Y, then I find that LY equals B, and I find that UX equals Y. So this is just introducing Y as U times X. So let's see. So what I've now basically done by introducing this variable, I started with a 3x3 linear system AX equals B, and with doing quite some work, I ended up with two linear systems of size 3x3. So you would say that I doubled the amount of work, but that's not exactly true, because these systems are much easier to solve than this system is, and I'll show you why. So if you look at Ly equals B with the L from the previous slide, we have this linear system. Now, if you look at the individual equations, what they say, then the first row of the matrix tells us that Y1 equals 1. So we don't have to solve for anything. The second equation tells us that 2y1 plus y2 equals 1. I have already found y1, so I can use this to find y2. And then from the last equation, I can find y3. So let's write that down. So the first equation immediately gives me y1. The second equation only involves y1 and y2 because L is lower triangular, which means that I can immediately find y2. And then the last equation gives us the value of y3. So I've solved this linear system. And this process, since you start at the top, and then basically the values that you find, you substitute them into the next equation. For that reason, it's called forward substitution. Next, I want to solve ux equals y. I have just found y in the previous step. That's the factor 1 minus 1 and 4. So if you now look at this linear system here, then you see that this one is also easier because here I can start with the last equation. The last equation tells me that 4 times x3 equals 4, so x3 equals 1. Then if I go to the second equation here, that involves x2 and x3, so I can solve it for x2. And then the top equation I use to find the value of x1. So writing that out in components, the last equation gives me x3, the second equation x2, and then we find x1. So since we now start at the end and we go upwards, this is called backward substitution. So now we have found a first non-final version of how a computer solves linear systems. But this is not the final one. So this is not the one that's actually implemented. This is a step towards the complete algorithm. So what we do is we first use Gaussian elimination to find a decomposition, A equals L times U. Then we solve Ly equals B using forward and Ux equals Y using backward substitution. Now, the reason that I say this is not a final version is that this won't always work. So you could wonder about that. Does it always work? And then if you look at this simple example here, so this matrix, of course, it's trivial, but you see that I cannot find the LU factorization here because I have a zero here at the top left. I cannot use that to create a zero below the diagonal. Now, if you think what it means, if you're going to solve a linear system with this matrix, you could simply swap the two equations, which means swapping the rows. The equations, it doesn't matter in which order you write them down. So what you could do here is swap the equations, and you can do that using a matrix P that looks like this. So 0, 1, 1, 0, that's called a permutation matrix because it simply swaps the order of the equations around. And then this is already upper triangular, so you can immediately solve this. But in general, you could get to a linear system where you can use LU factorization. So apparently, we need to swap rows if we want to do this LU factorization of any non-singular matrix. Now, the next idea is that we are using numerical mathematics here. And in numerical mathematics, you can wonder, when is a number zero? If it is very small, would it actually be zero or not? And if a number is very small, maybe I should treat it as being zero. So we see that if you work by hand, you already need to swap rows if you encounter a pivot. Pivot is the entry that you use to create zeros. That is zero. But for numerical stability, it makes sense to swap rows if you also encounter a pivot that's close to zero. So if the entry on the diagonal then is close to zero, then probably it is not a very good equation to eliminate an unknown from the other equations, which is basically what you're doing in Gaussian elimination. So we will use a strategy that is called partial pivoting. So how does that work? Say that we have this 7x7 matrix. We have already done a couple of steps in the Gaussian elimination and created zeros below the main diagonal. And now we're basically concentrating on this bottom right bit, this 4x4 bottom right bit of the matrix. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at these four red numbers. So a star means some non-zero number. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick the largest one in absolute value. So I take absolute value of all of them. Then I pick the largest one and I'm going to use that to create zeros. And this is called partial pivoting, because full pivoting would be to pick the biggest one of all 16, and then you would also have to swap columns around. That would be better in principle, but nobody does that because partial pivoting works very well. So this is what we will be using. So how does it work? Again, we have this matrix here. Now, if you look in the first column, I pick the largest entry, which is the 4. So I have to swap the first and second row to have this 4 at the top left. And then I find this matrix here. So I do some Gaussian elimination. And then I have this if you do the computations correctly. And now I have to look at this block here. And then in particular, the minus 1 and the 3, I have to pick the largest one in absolute value. So I have to pick the 3. So I have to swap once again. Let's swap around. So I use this permutation matrix to swap the order of the rows once again. Then if you do all the computations, you would end up with this. So we have this here. I use the 3 to create a 0 here. And then I have here upper triangular form. I have the red entries of my L matrix. So what we have now is that if you do the permutations times our matrix, I can write that as L times U with this L and this U. So one of the things that you see here is that our L matrix, all these entries now below the diagonal, are less than 1 in absolute value. So that should always happen if you do partial pivoting. Now, P2 and P1, I can take them together, and I can also write this as one permutation matrix, which I call P. And then I'm to the final stage of what we will do and how a computer solves numerically linear systems. So it's going to be LU decomposition with partial pivoting, and that is essential that you do that. So what we have found now, we had AX equals B. We multiply from the left with P. And PA, I can replace with LU. So now we have LUX equals PB. So the right-hand side also changes. We have to swap the entries of the B vector also. So what does that mean? First, a theorem that I'm not going to prove. It's quite technical to prove that, not very interesting. But if you have a non-singular matrix, then you can always find P, L, and U. So that's great. That will always work for a non-singular matrix. And the way that you use it then is you compute this P, L, and U in the way we did with Gaussian elimination and partial pivoting. Next, you rewrite your linear system. You first solve LY equals P times B using forward substitution, and that is very efficient as we have seen. And then finally, you solve UX equals Y using backward substitution. So that is the full algorithm, how a computer solves linear systems. If you ask MATLAB to solve a linear system for you, this is what will happen. So as I said, in the real world, so is this actually being used? Yes, it is. And what you see here is when Apple introduces Mac Pro, which was like its state-of-the-art fastest, biggest computer, they asked someone from a tech side, they asked like, well, how do you actually use it? And I thought it was funny because he told here that he tested it and he used LinPack, which is like a standard library for linear algebra. And he solved a dense system, so a matrix that has many non-zero entries, not a sparse matrix, but a dense matrix, a full matrix. 15,000, so 15,000 linear equations. So the matrix is 15,000 by 15,000. And it uses LU decomposition with partial pivoting. So Excellent. It is being used, and this guy that does it is a mechanical and aerospace engineer. So if you want to compute the flow around an airplane, that's computational fluid dynamics, and there you solve linear systems. Few remarks still on LU decomposition. Note that it does not depend on the right-hand side vector, so you only need a matrix. So if you have one linear system and you want to solve multiple systems with one matrix, different right-hand sides, you only have to do the LU factorization once. So that's what it says here. It only uses A, so if you have multiple right-hand sides, B is B1, B2, and so on, you can reuse your factorization. The computational costs are, well, something like a constant times n to the power 3, so our matrix is n times n for the LU computation. And the forward and backward substitution are cheaper. They are order of n squared, so the number of operations, so how many multiplications, additions you will need to compute it. So the determinant of P times A is determinant P times determinant A. A permutation matrix always has determinant plus 1 or minus 1. So it is plus or minus determinant of A. The determinant of L for a lower triangular matrix, it is the product of the diagonal entries. L has 1s on its diagonal, so this is 1. And for U, it's the product of the diagonal entries. So if you have the LU decomposition of your matrix, you can easily compute its determinant. And the way you could compute the inverse of a matrix is that you say, well, A times A inverse is the identity. Now, if I write A inverse in terms of its columns, and I call those columns x1 up to xn. Similarly, for the identity matrix, I write it in its columns. So here we have that E1 is 1, 0, 0, and all zeros. E2 is 0, 1, 0, and the rest zeros, up to En, the last one. And the last one is 0, 0, 0, and the last entry is 1. Then what you have is that A times these x vectors equals these e vectors. So basically you see that if you solve n linear systems, these linear systems, that is a way to compute the inverse. So to get an idea, computing the inverse of a matrix is approximately computationally the equivalent of solving n linear systems. So if you want to solve only one linear system, you should not compute first the inverse and then do A inverse times B. Because to compute A inverse, you're basically solving n linear systems, and then you have to do even additional work. So that is the last conclusion. So solving A inverse is as expensive as solving n linear systems. Last bit, how would you do this in MATLAB? So MATLAB has a number of routines. It has a command LU, and that stands for LU factorization. So if you call it like this, so in between square brackets, you can ask for LU and P, and those are the LU and P as I just discussed, permutation matrix, lower triangular, upper triangular. And next what you could do is use this. So the backslash is a smart way to solve linear systems. So MATLAB uses forward substitution here. It recognizes that this L is a lower triangular matrix. And then U backslash Y here, that uses backward substitution. You can also combine them, because you're not really interested in Y, you only want to know X, so you can also write it like this. You can also call the LU routine with just two matrices, and then M is not lower triangular, but it's basically something like P times L, so it's psychologically lower triangular. And MATLAB will use that structure if you do something like m backslash some vector, then it will solve that in a smart way. And if you only want to solve one linear system, then you don't care about L and U, and you don't have to store them. And then you can do x is a backslash b, and that solves the linear system in a smart way for you. So the standard way to solve linear systems in MATLAB is using the backslash operator. And it does that efficiently for you. MATLAB also has an INV command to compute the inverse, but probably you should not be using that because you don't want to solve linear systems that way. So what have we seen? We have seen how Gaussian elimination with partial pivoting works, which is the standard way to solve dense linear systems in all numerical algorithms. We have seen if you have this decomposition, how you can use it to solve those linear systems with forward, backward substitution. And we have seen how you can do that in MATLAB. So that wraps up this video. I hope you liked it and everything was clear. If not, let me know and I'll see you in the next video.